Welcome, this is Information Service Engineering, and this is the trailer for lecture number 7, Knowledge Graphs, part 2. Before we go into details about this lecture, let's first recapitulate what we did in the last lecture and to tell you what is really important about the lecture. So we were talking about knowledge representation and ontology. So what is an ontology in philosophy? What is an ontology in computer science, and how relates this to semantic web and semantic web technology, especially to the web of data? We have learned that there are some simple principles holding all the stuff together here in the web of data, and these are the so-called linked data principles. And we have learned what's the difference between a URI, a uniform resource identifier, and a uniform resource locator. Where by a URI, you can put on the web what exists. The URL tells you what exists on the web. But to go deeper into that and understand that, you have to watch, of course, the previous lecture. And then, of course, we were talking about how we really identify and access things on the web based on URIs. And there we learned the difference between designator and designatum. And of course, real things are not on the web. There are only their representations. However, we can use them and act with them and make statements and facts with them as if they were the things we are talking about themselves. And this is, of course, some principle that we already have adapted from the use of natural language too. And we know this kind of semiotics that we are in, this semiotic triangle, and how we are using that. And another thing we have already learned is that, of course, to access things here on the web, you have the possibility with the same web address to give different kind of information back. Like, for example, if I as a human ask there, I get back HTML. And if, let's say, a software agent comes and asks for information on the, under the same URI, then the information that comes back might be RDF. So this is simply solved via HTTP content negotiation. And this is basic web technology on which the semantic web and all we are talking about here is founded. And we distinguish between the fully fledged semantic web. We saw all these semantic web technologies in the semantic web technology stack. And we differentiated, of course, this fully fledged semantic web from a lightweight semantic web, which we see currently daily in the web of data. So there in the web of data, the things that are interconnected there. So this linked data is based on the linked data principles that we have talked about extensively, and that we will also recapitulate again in this lecture. Which brings me to the points of this lecture. So we will continue our journey through the semantic web technology stack. And the first thing we will learn in this lecture is then the resource description framework. This means we are learning how to create little statements representing small knowledge bits. So everything there is represented in terms of triples. You have a subject, you have a property, and you have an object, like in a real sentence. And you can represent this in terms of graphs. And these graphs can be also serialized. So this is something you will learn here when we are starting to talk about the resource description framework as a first simple data model. Since graphs are difficult to read, and also the representation of these URIs, if I always, you know, write them explicitly, is anything else but neat. Of course, languages or serialization formats have been invented, which are much easier to read and which gives you a much better overview. And one of them, so the most popular, is the RDF turtle serialization with lots of abbreviations, syntactic sugar, for example, which enables you then to write complex things in a rather, let's say, concise way, which is much better readable. Okay, this is RDF for representing simple facts. If you want to put more semantics in these facts, if you want to create your own data models, you need a schema language. And this we are talking about in the second chapter of this lecture, and this will be creating new models with RDFS, and this is the RDF schema language by which you can, for example, define class hierarchies, property hierarchies, class memberships, and so on, which is, of course, basic and really important. And since this is not a kind of traditional data representation or data schema language, this is an ontology-based language, this means there is explicit semantics available. And this explicit semantics that is behind these, let's say, simple keywords that come from the vocabularies of these languages, this enables a reasoner, which is a generic program which is able to do logical inferences and deductions, to deduce implicitly given facts and make them explicit. So for example, we can use the fact that a type definition is something like, said theoretically, you say that some instance is an element of a class. And this, of course, you can combine with a subclass statement, which from a set theoretical point of view also has a specific meaning. So it's transitive, for example, and you can make use of this transitivity and more. So what kind of logical inference can we already draw based on RDFS? We will learn here in the logical inference chapter, which follows here. And of course, most of all, we haven't talked about knowledge graphs at all. So the last chapter in this lecture will be dedicated simply to knowledge graphs. There we will define what is a knowledge graph and what is important for a knowledge graph. Of course, a knowledge graph, again, will be based on web standards, like, for example, W3C standards, RDF, OWL, and so on. And most importantly, you will see that these knowledge graphs are actually really used. They are used and are available in public large knowledge graphs, like, for example, DBpedia and also Wikidata, but also within commercial industry and products, you will find knowledge graphs. Microsoft is using knowledge graphs. Google is using knowledge graphs. eBay is using knowledge graphs. Amazon, of course, too. So all of the big e-commerce companies, all of the information systems of the search engines available, they are all making use of knowledge graphs. So this will be subject of the last chapter then of this lecture. Okay, so now we can start. Brace yourself because now everything, especially semantics, will become explicit.